Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of our God that we wish to contemplate for ourselves this morning is found recorded for us in the book of Job. I'll highlight for you Job 7, verse 7a. Remember, O God, that my life is but a breath. Thus far, God's word, but you and I continue in prayer. Oh, gracious and merciful God, we give you thanks for books like the book of Job. We believe that the book of Job is there that we might learn and grow in our understanding of not only how this world works, what we might be confronted with. But dear Lord, we are given insights even into you and your grace, mercy, and love. Help us to grasp this lesson, to live our lives in accord with it. This we ask in Jesus. Amen. So I can tell you when you look at the pericopes that we used in our church, now if you go to your hymnal right before the hymns, I believe, if you page back a few pages, you'll find the pericopes listed there, what the readings are going to be for the coming Sunday, the Sundays of the month, and all that stuff. When you look at those pericopes and you go through them all, what you'll discover is that the book of Job is only called upon twice to be preached on. And both of those instances, the book of Job is actually called for to be used in Series B of the ILCW series, and that's the series that we're using, and that happens to be the series, of course, that we're currently on this year. I can understand why you might only use Job or only refer to Job a couple of times, but I guess I would sit down to those who put those things together, and I would say, gosh, if you're going to use the book of Job, at least use some of the texts that are found in Job that are uplifting and positive, not really to the pressing words that you find in chapter 7, verses 1 through 7. And yet, I think the idea of just picking a text from Job is so that you can consider the message of the whole of Job and what it means for us. So if you would, we're just going to jump in, and we're going to talk about everything we can to make sure you get the point of Job. Our theme will be understanding Job. To begin, the book of Job starts by speaking of Job and his life. Job, it seems, lives or is a contemporary of the patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Some consider him to be a contemporary of Moses. Either way, what you need to grasp is that Job is called by the Lord, blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. And it's clear that Job in his life is blessed by the Lord. For we are told he has 7 sons, 3 daughters, 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 donkeys, and a large number of servants. But the book of Job also tells us that as the angels were presenting themselves before the Lord, Satan himself also came. Yes, I will tell you that Satan answers to the Lord and is limited by the Lord our God in what he can and can't do. Satan comes. And Satan challenges the Lord concerning Job, basically telling the Lord that Job is only a believer. Job only has confidence and trust in God because God has put a hedge around him. That's what the text says. And Satan challenges that if God were to take away Job's blessings, that Job would curse God. The Lord allows the challenge, making this stipulation to begin. Everything he has is in your hands, but on the man himself, do not lay a finger. Satan attacks, and it is as vicious as you and I would expect. In one day, Job will lose everything. First, his oxen and donkeys, and all the servants with them. The text basically says people came and attacked, and they took the donkeys and the oxen, and they killed all the servants, and only one was left to survive, and he's the one who ran back to Job. So by the time this is all done, Job's going to lose everything, except for his wife and 4 servants, maybe. And then comes the sheep and the servants. than come to camels in a service. And yeah, then his sons and daughters will all die. They're all together in one house having a banquet, and the house collapses, and all the servants around them are killed too, except for one. Let's come back and tell Job. By the time that day is over, everything, and I mean everything, that Job has is gone. And I need you to let that sink in. And I want you to consider such a loss in your life. And how would you respond? And do you remember how Job responded? Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Now that, dear people, is a confession of faith. That's what it means to trust God and to have no doubts ever that no matter what happens, the goodness, the grace, and the love of God still stands and still overcomes. Tragedy upon tragedy, and Job simply and wonderfully clings to the Lord. And if you would, just a little reminder to all of you to contemplate and imitate this wonderful faith of Job. And it's clear that Job's focus is not this life, what is found in this life. Job had a greater perspective, a confidence that though this life may be one of horror and grief, because of God's grace and goodness and love, it is all endurable. And I think we can say of Job's attitude, it is because of the Lord our God. It's because of the Lord our God that we can never lose, but we are always those who overcome the world and the cesspool this world can often be. And just so you know, that's exactly what you and I are reminded of in 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. For everyone born of God has or overcomes the world. And I think those are pretty awesome, pretty gracious things to think about. Of course, the history of Job doesn't end there. Satan is miffed because Job has not cursed God. And so Satan comes back making other accusations against the Lord. Satan says, skin for skin. A man will give all he has for his own life, but stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face. Please note that God will allow Satan to personally attack Job, but the limitation that Satan has is that he cannot take Job's life. Now, God and Satan know that, but I don't think Job does. Now, at this point, I think you and I need to be clear here, and we need to talk very clearly here. First, we don't know everything that God knows or every reason that God has for allowing this attack of Satan upon one of his children. We don't. And don't speculate or don't make accusations against God that are not true. What we do know is that these attacks are tests of faith. Now, a test of faith is where something happens to us, good or bad, that causes us to draw closer to God, to grow in our faith in God. And for us, it is the outcomes that determine if we have faced a test where we are drawn closer to God or a temptation where we have been drawn away from God, perhaps a temptation even to the point where we have lost our faith. And tests can come in any form or fashion. They can come at any time or any point of our lives, young, old, you know, middle-aged, teen, senile, God. Tests can be short or long, lightweight, or crushing. And here's something important to know. No matter what you are going through, your choice as a child of God, is either to completely trust in God, to trust His love and grace, to know that He is a God who is not the author or the doer of evil, but who is always, always working in your life to make your salvation sure and certain. And please note that God will never, ever work outside of what He has revealed in His Word. The other choice you have is to be filled with anger, filled with despair, or filled with rejection of God. To decide that God is evil or weak, or that God is worthless, that God cannot or that God will not love you. And I also want you to remember that it's not always the bad things that become our temptations. Sometimes it is good things that Satan uses to destroy our souls and our faith. Satan may bless you with wealth. And that money becomes everything to you so that you turn away from God. Or Satan may bless you with love. Well, our silly ideas sometimes of love. And I think especially of our young people. So many of them who have, for the sake of some significant other, abandoned their faith in God. Or it might be happiness. Or maybe He's just given you a wonderful kids and a family, and you get so wrapped up in them, but you forget about God and church. I mean, you get the picture? If the end result of what is going on in your life is that you turn away from, or you become a person who is filled with despair and anger, and you reject the Lord, you have been lured into a temptation of Satan to the destruction of your soul. Now, why do I say all this? Because this study of Job is in many ways a study of exactly what Satan may throw at us. For Job, he's going to lose everything, and then he's going to be struck with complete illness, boils that cover his body, and his only relief is scraping himself with a piece of pottery. His wife begs him to curse the Lord and die. He will have three friends who supposedly come to give him comfort and help, but they are the absolute worst friends ever. These friends come and they attack Job's faith. They attack Job's integrity. They attack Job's wisdom and knowledge in the Lord. And they do all of this in the name of God and knowledge. And yet those three friends are not godly. They are not knowledgeable, and they are not those who speak the truth of God. And it's because of the people around him and the bodily difficulties that Job has that we do hear some of the things we do, and they can be quite negative, as the words of our text. Just listen again to those words. Does not man have heart service on earth? Are not his days like those of a hired man? Like a slave longing for the evening shadows, or a hired man waiting eagerly for his wages. So I have been allotted months of futility, and nights of misery have been assigned to me. When I lie down, I think, how long before I get up? The night drags on, and I toss till dawn. My body is clothed with worms and scabs. My skin is broken and festering. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and they come to an end without hope. Remember, O God, that my life is but a breath. My eyes will never see happiness again. Do you catch the despair and the agony of this man? His suffering is clear. He is suffering. He's having an absolute bad time. And you can hear his agony in his words. And if you can't identify with this man and his misery, then I would suggest that you maybe pinch yourself to see if you're still alive in this world. Now, maybe all of us haven't been as deep in despair or as hard-pressed as Job is physically, but we have all had our share of problems and troubles, so that these words and the sadness of these words strikes a chord. And yeah, the truth of the matter, since we all know each other so well, is that every one of us has had those moments, those times of trouble and hardship that just seem to make life a place of cruelty and darkness. Well, dear people, welcome to the fact that our world is tainted by sin and all the problems that sin brings. That's the fact. And I pray that if your struggles are like Job's, that you at least have a Christian support system around you and not friends like Job had, friends who lead you to the world's ways or who confuse and distort the whole thing. What was going on? And here's what I will tell you. I'm going to kind of sum up the rest of Job's struggles in a nutshell. Job, as you read the book, rest of the book, Job will literally despair of his life. Job curses his existence. He tries to fight off his friend's bad advice, and yes, Job will question God, and Job will wrestle with God's role in the misery he is in through questions. And this dialogue that takes place, you have to understand that the book of Job is written in a dialogue format. The dialogue that takes place in the book of Job, it just seems to go on forever, but I will tell you that there are lessons galore to be learned in the book of Job. So let me just share with you some of those lessons, what I think that are important for this morning. Lesson one. No matter what you think, no matter what you think you read in Job, or that you think that somehow Job has said something evil or wicked, you need to understand you would be wrong. Because here's what God, who speaks at the end, says. My servant Job will pray for you. And actually, God is addressing the three friends. And God's not very happy with them. My servant Job will pray for you, and I will accept his prayer and not deal with you according to your folly. You have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has. And again, let that sink in. It's true, there are times when Job seems in his questions to go too far, and yet God says he did not. So if you're going to sit down, you're going to read the book of Job, read it carefully, and always read it with this fact in mind that God says Job does not sin. Lesson two. Though Job may despair of his earthly life, and he does, and Job may curse his misery, please note that Job does maintain his faith in the promises of God. And to grasp that, just consider the most famous passage of Job. Job chapter 19, verses 23 through 27. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth, and after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I, and not another. How my heart yearns within me. In those words, Job is confessing his trust in the promised Savior, and that because of that Savior, he knows one day he will be alive again. He will see God with his own eyes, and he will reap the benefits of what God has promised, eternal life and salvation. Nothing in this world can ever, ever trump this heavenly, eternal life promise of God. Lesson three. In Job, God still comes across as God. And I find it wonderful that when God does speak, it is with challenges and with the absolute authority of himself as God. So when God begins to speak, and I think it's chapter 38. When God begins to speak, he begins with these words. Who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you will answer me. See, the value of this lesson, of all the questions that God throws at man, questions that we cannot answer or even get close to answering, remind us clearly and truly that God is God. I believe it's okay to ask questions of God, to seek the answers of His Word, but it is not okay to presume that you have greater knowledge or greater insight or greater wisdom than God. I will tell you point blank that the moment you begin to think that you know more than God, then you're really not worshiping or even having faith in the true and only God. God is what He says He is and not what we want to think He is. To seek answers is one thing. And again, to decide that your wisdom, the world's wisdom, is greater than God's is quite another. And most of you are aware of the motto that's really been the motto of my entire ministry. When the office was up here, it was a printed sheet that actually hung in my wall. And now if you go down to my office downstairs, you'll see that it's a little plaque that one of the members gave me on my 25th anniversary. God said it. I believe it. That settles it. God is God. Lesson 4. Even in misery, it's clear, as I pointed out already, Job held on to the hope and joy of eternal life with the Lord. For those who believe, that has never changed. Which means it applies directly to you. Paul wrote in Romans, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. Or how about 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 9? But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Or how about just verse 17 of that very same chapter and verse? For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. The promises, the power, the wonder of our God found in Jesus is our everything. And because of His victorious redemption, we have the wonder of eternal life and salvation with the Lord. And it's this promise, this hope, that is our foundation and our complete hope in everything. Well, thank you, Lord. Thank you for this book and its lessons. And may we have the faith of Job. May our lives, no matter what trial you bring upon us, be to the glory of Jesus and draw us all the more to the confidence of eternal life and salvation. Amen.